Thank you. It's good to be back here. The big thing for yesterday, of course, we showed some very neat footage of a new find in Iowa, which just happens to be directly across from the Nauvoo Temple. And what we're going to do today is I can't cover that same material because it's not fair to those who are here for both days. I will show you just a few images of that a little later on in the presentation. They'll just come up as we flow through it. But the talk today is we're going to show parallels between the Hopewell culture and the Book of Mormon, and we're going to put some emphasis on Joseph Smith and some things that he had to go through to make this happen, and the things that statements that he's put forth that really has given us courage to do what we do. But first of all, I want to teach you a greeting from the Native Americans of the Great Lakes. Are you all ready? I want you to say the word, aho.
Aho.
Raise your arm, aho.
Aho.
That means I come in peace, I bear no arms. That's a standard saying amongst all the different tribes, so that way when they're out doing their hunter and gathering, if one group runs into another group, what they do is automatically it's aho, and that everybody can go and pass in peace and not have any problems. So I think it's pretty neat. Even yet today, they still greet each other with aho around the Great Lakes. So hang on to that. It might be helpful someday. All right. let's go ahead here. This land, a land of promise, the forested canopy of North America's trees, has kept a secret that would not be realized until the 1830s. Interesting date. When a great work was set in motion to survey the earthen mounds, the embankments of circles, rectangles, the causeways of an ancient people have long since slept beneath the soil blanket of the Ohio and the Mississippi River territories. E.G. Squire and Davis, who preserved a small but important portion of these monuments, did so within the pages of their notes from surveys and explorations published in 1847, 1848. If you want to see the fortifications and you cannot get back to the Ohio, these are the two books where you'll find both of them. This one here is just by Squire. This is the more famous one that's by both of them. And you'll find the complete works in here of what they surveyed. Without the work of these two gentlemen, we would be very handicapped to show the things that you're going to see today. These are typical examples of the earthworks. We call these the small forts. These are the geometric works. They're quite large. Again, demonstrating that these people understood surveying. They understood high math. And these works, unlike a lot of these smaller works, the berms were thrown up. They were actually engineered, layers of gravel and clay and other types of earth. And then on the high places, this represents elevation. On the high places, peninsulas and hilltops, they would also then turn this into a place of resort or a fortified area. This is an actual wall they built, but because of elevation, this could be easily defended on three sides. But this side here is the approach, and so they would defend that off very easily with a wall, sometimes moats, sometimes just one or the other. So these are typical examples of the works. Now, I showed this yesterday, but I think it's appropriate today. Early on in the church, as people came through Mormondom and joined the church, they saw the works of the Ohio, and for them, it was very easy to accept the history as given to them in the Book of Mormon. And I want to show this Book of Mormon, 3rd Chicago edition. If you look up here for the purple, nevertheless, thou beholdest that the Gentiles who have gone forth out of captivity, notice the purple for Gentiles, United States. Neither will he suffer that the Gentiles shall destroy the seed of thy brethren, down to the yellow, the Indians, of whom I speak in the seed of thy father, wherefore after I have visited them in judgment and smitten them, red, Indians. So early on, I got a feel that most of the saints, along with the early brethren of the church, were very pro-North America. So somewhere along the line, that shift took place into Mesoamerica. So Hugh Nibley says, blinded by the gold of the pharaohs and the mighty ruins of Babylon, Book of Mormon students have declared themselves not interested in the drab and commonplace remains of our lowly North American Indians. But in all the Book of Mormon, we look in vain for anything that promises majestic ruins. Is that not the case? We have fell in love with the stone structures of Central America. Terrific archaeology, they got a great story, but it's not the story for the Book of Mormon. Showed this yesterday, the Billings and Palenque were constructed in Ottoman times, beginning about AD 600. The earliest dated Billings and Palenque are over two centuries after the final destruction recounted in the Book of Mormon. This happens to be my favorite painting in the church by Lewis A. Ramsey. And this unofficially was kind of my first, I should say officially and unofficially, was my first pat on the back from the brethren of the church. If you've seen my books, this is the cover of my third book, and I wanted to use this for my cover really bad, and I called the church headquarters, the corporate office, and they said, send in your manuscript, and I did, and they held it for 9 months, and I had a backup cover to use if they rejected it, because I had no reason why they would accept it. I just thought I'd ask, because it's my favorite painting. And lo and behold, they contacted me 9 months and said, you can use our painting, and I was able to do this on my third book. So I was very, very appreciative. It was kind of my flagship. So, Elder LeGrand Richards, responding to a question from Dr. Paul Chesman, director of the Book of Mormon Studies at BYU's Religious Studies Center in the 1960s, said, I heard Brother Callis once say that when Joseph Smith received the plates, he got down on his knees before the Lord and said, oh God, what will the world say? And the voice of God came to him, fear not, I will cause the earth to testify the truth of these things. Taken from the letter of LeGrand Richards to Paul R. Chesman in 1969. Now, it's very interesting. Joseph, early on, I'm sure, was into the archaeology of the Book of Mormon because of this statement right here. I'm not going to read this. 1775, way before the Book of Mormon was published, in the city of Lexington, over 200 mummified bodies were found in a cavern right beneath the streets of Lexington. The people who lived there, being upset with the Native Americans, they pulled these out in the city center, and they burned and trashed all mummified remains. But Joseph, knowing about it 60 years later, he commented on it, and it's found in the teachings of Joseph Smith the Prophet, a book which probably most of you have in your homes. He said, had Mr. Ash in his researches consulted the Book of Mormon, his problem would have been solved, and he would have found no difficulty in accounting for the mummies being found in the above-mentioned case. The Book of Mormon gives an account of a number of descendants of Israel coming to this continent, and it is well known that the art of embalming was known among the Hebrews as well as the Egyptians, Genesis 50, 2, 3, and 26. Now, concerning North America and where the Israelites landed in the Promised Land, do you see another hint in here? There's a major hint in here. That's it. Continent. He didn't say Americas. He did not say Western Hemisphere. He said continent. And where's Joseph standing? Right here. This continent, North America. Joseph, though, even all this has taken place, we still have our troubles today. National Geographic, 1998, letter to the Institution of Religious Research. Archaeologists and other scholars have long probed the hemisphere's past, and the society does not know of anything found so far that has substantiated the Book of Mormon. All I can say is really. Smithsonian Institution issued an official statement in 96 and again in 98 that it considered the Book of Mormon to be a religious document and not a scientific guide, and that it has found no archaeological evidence to support the book's claims. Well, we're going to change all that, okay? It's interesting to note, this is 98. What also began in 1988 for the first time? What came pouring out of the scientific community? Starts with a D.
DNA.
DNA, thank you very much. They've been very quiet since that happened. Some Mormon archaeologists and researchers claim various archaeological findings such as place names and ruins of the Inca, Maya, Olmec, and other ancient American and Old World civilizations as giving credence to the Book of Mormon record. Critics and non-Mormon archaeologists, now these are their peers of the Meso supporters, disagree with these conclusions, arguing that the Book of Mormon mentions several animals, plants, and technologies that are not substantiated by the archaeological record between 3100 BC to 400 AD in America, including the following: the ass, the cow, the horse, the ox, domesticated sheep, swine, goats, elephants, wheat, barley, silk, steel, swords, scimitars, chariots, and other elements. No Hebrew found at Inca or Maya sites at all. And that's true. Nothing has been found. Additionally, scientists note that genetic studies show that Amerindian peoples are most likely of Asiatic origin, which appears to conflict with the Book of Mormon account of their ancestry. Again, this was all done in 1998, and they've been very silent since the DNA hit. Now, I call this the Big 20. We can take a peek at it a little closer. Had these people accepted all the early books, and this is just a small portion, these early books, even though the discipline of archaeology is not developed yet, these people here All these books report of all kinds of findings that support the Book of Mormon. But all this material is not used today because they are, quote, not archaeologists. And that is absolutely wrong. I'm going to give you one example. This comes from Reverend Stephen D. Peet, who is one of our early record keepers. During this time, 400 years of America's discovery, there have been many discoveries. Consequently, many changes of thought. These discoveries and changes have had regard first to the mound builder's problem. Some 40 years ago, it was held that the Mississippi Valley must have been settled by a civilized people who had migrated from some historic country. Silver sword scabbards, iron knives, Hebrew inscriptions, triune vases, and other curious relics were dwelt upon, proving this and give increasing evidence of pre-Columbian contact with other countries. This is just one example, and there are hundreds, and I do mean hundreds. So let's take a peek at that big 20 again. Now, in all fairness, I just kind of went through here very quickly. Let's take a look at them. Number one, the Adena and the Hopewell replaced the Inca, the Maya, and the Olmec, because we're looking at North America. So that takes care of those three. Now, the Adena are my choice for the Jaredite timeline. Yes, we do have them, but we don't have a lot of evidence because of the age. But we do know the bones were big and robust, and they were large, 6 foot for the women, 7 foot for the men. Hopewell, we have a tremendous amount of material, and that's what we're going to see mostly today. I've found no record for any asses to be found, except for in academia. I couldn't avoid that one. I'm sorry. Cow, I have actually 3 sites now for cows. I have 1 good site for horse. I have 1 site for ox. I've found no examples for sheep yet, none for swine. Goats, 1 site. Elephants, numerous sites. Numerous. Wheat. Not yet. Now, I've caught wind that they found some barley, but I don't have the information yet. That's happening right now. Silk, I've not found that yet. Swords, yes, we got swords. And steel, 1 site. Scimitars, we have scimitars. That's a curved sword. Chariots, no. Hebrew script, nothing south of the Rio Grande. We've got about 14 places here in North America. And every single place except one has been declared hoax. Fraud, spurious. These are the words you'll find. And then we have DNA, of course, which is brand new, and boy, we have got it around the Great Lakes. Nowhere else. It's right here in North America. Right where Joseph said it was. So let's take a peek at the 20. Now, what I did, and these need to be updated, I put out the sheet. This will be on my webpage, free download for you, so don't worry about writing it down. I'd use for comparisons, Book of Mormon. Here's the Hopewell comparisons, and I'm not going to read all this, but they're absolutely numerous. I got 4 pages of them. I have to update them because I got a lot more to add to it and some better stuff and some numbers to add. All these things are comparisons from the Book of Mormon to what's going on in the Hopewell culture of North America, and we're going to see a lot of this just a minute in picture form. But I wanted to show you how numerous they are. The Hopewell people are so close to what we read in the Book of Mormon, it's just amazing. Okay? And this will be a free download on my site. Now, archaeological evidence shows that the only people known to have developed written languages in America were the Olmec, the Maya, whose written languages have no resemblance to Hebrew or Egyptian hieroglyphs. And I agree with that. They don't. They're their separate animal. Additionally, professional linguists and Egyptologists do not consider the Anthon transcript document to contain any legitimate ancient writing. Klaus Baer, Egyptologist at the University of Chicago, called the characters of the transcript nothing but doodlings. Interesting. Well, let's take a peek. In the Book of Mormon, we find this. And if our plates had been sufficiently large, we should have written in Hebrew, but the Hebrew hath been altered by us also. And if we could have written in Hebrew, behold, ye would have had no imperfection in our record. But the Lord knoweth the things which we have written, and also that none of the people knoweth our language. And because that none other people knoweth our language, therefore he hath prepared the means for the interpretation thereof. And what are the means? Absolutely. Let's take a peek. Here's the Anthon transcript. Now, this was pointed out to me about a little over a year ago now, and I thought it was a very good idea. As we look at this, here's the Anthon characters, And you notice the paper is not all that large. And it looks like someone is writing these down, which obviously they did. They're going along. And along about here, or maybe this line, they begin to realize that they want to put a whole bunch more on that single piece of paper. And what do? They start writing smaller and smaller and smaller. If we could read or translate this, I'm sure this is a complete statement or maybe a complete paragraph or a complete thought of several verses that go together. Because whatever it was, Joseph or Oliver, whoever did this, they felt it all had to be on there together because they began to squeeze the letters. They run out of space of paper. So anyway, let's push on. Now, in the 1970s, Dr. Barry Fell comes along and he sees a book called the Book of Prayers that the Algonquin Indians of the Northeast are using, who are called the Mi'kmaq. In the 1700s, the Jesuit priests come in there and they want to teach the Mi'kmaq their catechism so they convert them to Catholicism. And what they discover is that these Mi'kmaq Indians have a written language, and these are their characters. And as Dr. Barry Fell spotted this, he recognized these characters were, in his own words, Egyptian hieratic.
The first step away from the picture hieroglyphs of ancient Egypt. And so we take that and we look at it, we find 17 characters here. This right here is the Anthem letter characters. And on the right side is the Mi'kmaq in English out of the Book of Prayers. And as you can see, extremely close, if not even exact. We've got 17 very good matches.
This language of the Mi'kmaq is still written and spoken today in Vermont, Maine, and Upper Canada's. Mi'kmaq written language here in North America. Imagine that. 1994, I'm in Golden Valley, Minnesota, and I'm showing a whole bunch of pictures of the mystic symbol, the tablets of Michigan, and I didn't know much about it. I was just showing one image after another and after another, and when I finished, of all things, I had a Native American walk up and want to tell me about this. Guess what tribe he was from? Ojibwa. The Ojibwa. Where do we find the highest concentration of Mideast DNA? Ojibwa. 50% Ojibwa, Minnesota, Wisconsin, and Canada. Anyway, I get done. He comes up and he says, you know, this right here is Creator's name. And I said, really? He said, yeah, this is Creator's name. He says, this is cuneiform. Well, he really had my attention. So I said, well, can you make the sound? He said, I can. He said, you read this right to left, and this is how you pronounce it, Yod-Heh-Vav. Yod-Heh-Vav. Well, now he really had my attention. So what I did was I wrote that down, and upon getting home, I contacted two epigraphers that I knew, one on the East Coast that was non-LDS, and the second guy on in Utah, in Midvale of all things, and he was LDS, and I wrote them a letter. I gave them this symbol, and I didn't say anything about what I had found out. I just asked them, can you help me with this symbol? What is this? And both men wrote back and said, this is a Hebrew tetragrammaton. And you read it right to left, and it says, Yod, He, Va. Just like the Ojibwa Indian had told me. And then later on, I found it in this book. Tetragrammaton, a father's sacred name, is comprised of the three sacred letters, the Yod, the He, and the Va. Book is Keys of Enoch, Book of Knowledge, Dr. James Hertak. If you write it in Hebrew today, this is how you would write it. This is the Yod, this is the He, and this is the Va. Yod, He, Va. What is cuneiform, a language from 3 to 1500 BC, 3000, what is it doing in North America? That's the first question. How did it get here? Why is it here? And why are the Ojibwe Indians of the Wisconsin and Minnesota still using it today? Questions. This is an atypical Michigan tablet. This one is extremely unusual because of the top panel, which we're going to talk about. This is the top panel. Here's the middle in picture form. This is the Michigan script. And down here is the mystic symbol, the Yod, the He, and the Va. All these plates, approximately 10,000, were pulled out of Michigan from these dates, the 40s to the 1920s, and the tremendous fight. I mean, it was a fight from day one all the way into the 1920s. The naysayers won out because they were in power, and this whole collection was declared fraudulent because nobody was here before Columbus. The Indians could not have done this. And we know nobody had the skill to sail across the oceans. We know that, right? So that's the mindset. However, all did not agree. Now what we see here, this top, it looks like Egyptian hieroglyphics. And indeed it is. And David Allen Deal did the work on this. You can go pick up Budge's work on the Egyptian hieroglyphics. Any bookstore has the two-volume set. Here they are, redrawn, so you can see them plainly. And here's the translation of each glyph. Now, the only difference comes in epigraphers is how you would put this into a sentence form. Otherwise, this is perfect Egyptian. So now, the people in Michigan, not only do they have cuneiform, they have Egyptian hieroglyphics. And we have Egyptian hieratic, the next step away from this, sitting on the East Coast above New York. What is this stuff doing in North America? And then I find out that Chief Joseph, captured in the 1880s in Montana, put on a reservation in Wyoming. He had a medicine pouch around his neck, which is normal. The pouch was removed by the U.S. Cavalry, and in that pouch, he had a 1-inch by 1-inch square tablet in cuneiform. And when asked what this was, he says, "This is a tablet that belongs to my ancient ancestors." This tablet today is in West Point in their military museum. If you're out there, you can see it. Cuneiform, Chief Joseph. This is the Bat Creek Stone that Scott Walter has just really championed for us. This is actually the property of the Cherokees. However, it was in the Smithsonian Museum. Scott and crew went there as professionals to ask to examine this. They were refused. We had to go back and go through counsel into the elders of the Eastern Band of Cherokee. They gave us permission, and they went and retrieved the stone from the Smithsonian. And all the testing was done in Tennessee under control conditions, and it all came back that this is definitely authentic. And however old they want to date the bodies, the 9 bodies removed from the mound at Bat Creek, at this stone has to be the same age. The carbon dating on the bodies at Bat Creek is 1 to 150 AD. And this is Hebrew. This was first spotted by Henriette Mertz, champion of the Michigan tablets, and she said the stone was Phoenician. She contacted Cyrus Gordon. Gordon studied it and came out in 1971 that this was a real stone, yet all this time passed, totally ignored, until we could get it out just this past year in 2010. And guess what? Everything went silent again. Nothing is done in the archaeological record, even though the geologists have championed the stone. Our geologists are championing the stone. Deborah Bolnick, which I'm not sure if you saw this earlier or not, but again, this is just one little clip on the DNA. There are several. The DNA samples removed from 2 Hopewell cemeteries, Illinois and Ohio. DNA markers found in the Native Americans were present in both cemeteries, A, B, C, D, and X. X is the one we're looking for. Also, a single marker called X2A was also present in the Native American Indian population that carry the X marker. In the Upper Great Plains, as high as 25 to 50%. This X2A marker is not found in Asia or Europe. However, it is found in the Near East or Middle East and is ancient in its origin. This is live right now from last year. Now, this is brand new, March, off our list of 20, talking about cattle. I turned this over, she looked at it a little better. What does that look like? You find this in India and Egypt today, alive walking the streets. This is from somewhere in the south. I can't tell you where yet. It's brand new, and we're having it examined. Very exciting, and there's other things with this. This will be coming out in the pages of Ancient American probably in June, or for sure in the fall, because it's happening right now. This is cattle. Here's our cattle, one of our cattle answers. Okay, how could the Indians do this if they did not have knowledge of this beast? Because it's alive today. So, what is Hopewell in North America? That's the question. Here's the big map of all the mounds, the fortress, the cities, the towns they lived in, always on waterways. The rivers were the highways. That's how they traveled. This is my choice for the match to the Hopewell and the Nephite culture. This is where they lived. I call this parallels in time. We can never absolutely pick it out for sure, and I always tell everybody, you go out somewhere, I don't care where you go, here, Wisconsin, Tennessee, Florida, wherever you go, you pick up a really neat artifact, and you turn over in the back, and it says Maiden Zarahemla. Not going to happen. That's why I call it parallels in time. And it's like doing genealogy without the hardcore data. We have to go to multiple sources, multiple records. And that's what we're going to do. So let's take a peek. Where do we get our copper? Our copper comes from the Keweenaw. We have over 10,000 ancient copper mines just in the Keweenaw. We got about 5,000 on Isle Royale. This place was very, very busy for a very, very long time. The Jaredites, when they got here, they tell us we threw up banks of earth. They retrieved copper. The Nephites retrieved copper. Nephi had copper for his first temple, which we'll talk about in a little bit. But this is their area. Of course, this is Wisconsin where I live. This today is Upper Michigan, and that borderline runs right about here. And I'm here to tell you that borderline should have never happened. Okay? Doggone old Michigan, just because they got to be a state 10 years before we were. They came up here and took this because of the copper, because this was part of the Northwest Territory. Okay? The problem with that is I have to deal with two state archaeologists instead of one. That's my concern. All right. So Captain Moroni's fortifications of Nephite cities begins in 72 BC. They can no longer take the Lamanites on face to face, so they got to fortify their cities. So the question is, what do we find today? Are there ditches like we find in the Book of Mormon? Do we find banks of earth? Do we find wood palisades? Do we find something that would describe as the place of entrance? Let's take a look. Again, these are the two books where you're going to find all the fortifications of Western New York and the Mississippi Valley in Ohio. This is the small fort. This actually was the very first one excavated by the Smithsonian. And so every fort that matched this archaeological data after this became whatever they decided to call this place. They could have called this the Johnson Place, the Maori Place, the May Place, but the guy who lived there was Mordecai Hopewell. And so from this day on, anything that matched this archaeological data would be called a Hopewell site. That's how names are derived. So this is what I call a small fort. Notice the light color lines, that's the earth berm. The black line is the ditch where they threw up to build their fortification. And then again, we get a little good solid geometry over here. Nice lines, and these are a little rough. And again, here's the water. Always by water. And then we have a few of these hilltop forts. These are big. This one here is 2.5 miles around. This is Fort Hill in Ohio. It's a state park. You can go there and walk it today. There are 33 openings around this wall. And there's one main door right here. The archaeologists say that these are all doorways, all 33. And I got to tell you, if you go here and find out how steep this this represents elevation, how steep this is, you're going to ask yourself, how in the world am I going to get up this bank? They're not doorways, people. These are where the bastions of wood stood, as talked about in the Book of Mormon. I'm going to show you that in a minute. But they had one main way in, one main way out, and it's right here. This is the place of entrance, and we'll demonstrate that just in a minute. This is the geometric work. These are very, very fancy. You got a great lecture yesterday from Mr. Moats on what he was doing with one that's extremely rare. These are more common, but again, you can see that the work is extremely well done, very much laid out. We do find, again, archaeological settings within these earthworks. And what's neat about this, I talked to the fellows in Ohio at the MES, and I asked them, I said, if you had to give an average date, when the geometric works were built, what would be your average date? And what came back to me was 150 AD. Now, right away, that struck a real strong chord with me. Because to build something of this sophistication, you could not do it during times of trouble. You had to have a stable economy, no warfare going on. You had to have lots of people gathering food so that high-skilled laborers could build these types of things. And so what's going on in the Promised Land at 150 AD? What's happening? Peace. Right out of the Book of Mormon, another parallel. Peacetime. That's when these things could be built. A nice parallel. So Alma 49:18. Now behold, the Lamanites could not get into their forts of security by any other way save by the entrance, because of the highness of the bank which had been thrown up and the depth of the ditch which had been dug round about, save it were by, again, entrance. Keep that in mind. Ditch, highness of the bank, entrance. The Nephites had to fight a defensive campaign. They could not take them on in open combat. So what do we find in Ohio? This is a bank of earth about 25 feet. It's about 35 to 40 feet at the base. It would have been even bigger than this when this was built. And originally, there was a ditch out here. It's been filled in by farmers. Banks of earth. This also is a bank of earth. This is in Indiana. This one is built very well. And of course, here's the ditch. And here's the inside top ditch, bank of earth. Now, you might think this looks kind of small. You can't tell how big the trees are, can you? How's that? A little different, isn't it? These things are huge. This was not built by any 10 families of woodland gathering Indians picking nuts and berries in the forest. These are high sophisticated structures. These people were highly intelligent and they knew what to do to protect themselves. This happens to be a place of entrance. It's one of my favorites. I have to watch out for cars and trucks, obviously. This is a place of entrance. This is that 25-foot high bank. This is at Fort Ancient in Ohio. This is Highway 350 coming through here. This comes in, this is the east gate. It also drives in a west gate over here, and you drive right through the fort. A lot of people that live here in Ohio don't even realize they're driving through a fortification because it's every day. They're just running by. Alma 49, 20, and 21. And thus they were prepared, yea, body their strongest men with their swords and their slings to smite down all who should attempt to come into their place of security by where? Place of entrance. Key. The Lamanites brought up their armies before the place of entrance. And what happened? It wasn't very good. Now, here's one of the best examples. This is Ross County. 16-acre enclosure, 250 feet to the top. Again, all this brown represents elevation. These are places of escape if the fort should fail. But here, this is the place of entrance. The enemy has to attack this way. Defenders are right here in this area. Walls currently are only 5 feet with a 35-foot base. If these were blown up to where they think they would, they'd probably be standing about 12 to 15 feet when they were originally built. So, let's take a look at this. Bad guys show up out here, and they're going to attack the banks. The blue guys are the defenders. They're on top of the berms. They're in the towers, okay? And they're loaded with bear. They've got everything going for them. Now, the red guys, they can't climb over the bank. It's too steep. Can't go into the ditch. So they got to run through here, and they're going to squeeze through here because this is fall. They're going to fall off on the steepness. So as they squeeze through here, what happens to them? They get compacted, don't they? You're getting pressed together really tight. That means the guys here on the ends, all they got to do is throw rocks down on them. They're going to hit somebody. Doesn't matter. So the next, they approach. They come through the squeeze area. They make the turn. And the whole time they're doing this, they're getting hit now from crossfire, all these blue dots. They're in the crossfire. They're really taking it hard. They got to protect their heads. They have to. Finally, they break through. The guys that go here to the left, they're really in trouble. They find out there's no way to get over this bank. They got to turn and come back the whole time, still getting shot at, one after another. And finally, if they have a big enough force, they make the turn and they get in. And what's standing right here? Fresh defender army. And do they need to worry about their heads? No. They got both hands to fight with. But these red guys still have to worry about their heads because they're being hit from the top. This is a killing field developed by the Hopewell people. And I believe this is a killing field that Captain Moroni developed to protect them in their places of security. And this was effective for a very, very long time till the end. The defenses worked. Place of entrance, Alma. Alma 50 and 2 through 4. Upon the tops of these ridges of earth, he caused there should be timbers, yea, timbers built to the height of a man, round about the cities. And he caused that upon those works of timbers there should be a frame of pickets built upon the timbers. And he caused towers to be erected that overlooked those works of pickets. And these are the towers. These have all been designed by archaeologists because they have found post molds, the remains of the logs, and these are the shapes that they have found, generally speaking, and different sizes. And sometimes these wooden structures have been covered some kind of a plaster. If you talk to the archaeologists at Mound City, Ohio, they will actually use the word cement. Okay? I think that's kind of key. And so what happens on the dating? These are the average dates on the wood plug that they find here in the bottom. 30 AD, 230 AD, 430 AD. And carbon dating is not exact, but how close do we need to get? It's pretty nice. Parallels. Hard archaeology with Book of Mormon. Alma 51 through 6. Moroni did not stop making preparations for war. They commenced in digging up heaps of earth round about all the cities throughout all the land. He caused timbers, works of timbers built to the height of a man, round about the cities, a frame of pickets built upon the timbers, strong and high, and he caused towers to be erected that overlooked those works. He caused places of security to be built upon those towers. Thus Moroni did prepare strongholds against the coming of their enemies round about every city in all the land. Book of Mormon, 72 B.C. Now you've just seen all the stuff that they built. Okay? What about all the numerous cities we have according to the Book of Mormon? Would you not agree it's a big number? Yes? If they fortified them, like you've just seen they did, how much wasted wood, tops, stumps, would they have left to get rid of? Quite a bit. Would you not agree? And what are they going to do with it? Burn it. Do we have any evidence of that? We go to the North Pole and the South Pole and we take core samples down into the ice. Why? Because snowfall of every year that goes by, and as that builds, it collects the carbon material that's in the air and it leaves a record of what's in the air. Just this year, we have another fantastic parallel. Stalagmites reveals carbon footprint of early Native Americans, 2010. Here's the guy doing the work, University of Ohio. Chemical analysis of stalagmites found in the mountainous Buckeye Creek Basin of West Virginia suggests that Native people contributed a significant level of greenhouse gases to the atmosphere through land use practices. The early Native Americans burned trees to actively manage the forest. To their surprise, the carbon record contained evidence of a major change in the local ecosystem beginning at 100 B.C. When did Cap Moroni start? 72 B.C. Another nice parallel. This evidence suggests that Native Americans significantly altered the local ecosystem by clearing and burning forests. These are non-LDS people doing the work. Parallels. Coming out of the ground. 49 and 4 and 5 out of Alma. But behold, how great was their disappointment. For behold, the Nephites had dug up a ridge of earth round about them, which was so high that the Lamanites could not cast their stones, this is very important, cast their stones and their arrows at them that they might take effect, neither could they come by the place of entrance. Anyway, I believe the weapon of choice for the Lamanite people was the atlatl, casting of arrows. If you hold a bow in your hand and you draw back the string and you release it, am I casting an arrow? I'm shooting, aren't I? And we know this because in Helaman, what happened to the prophet as he climbed the wall to speak to the wicked Nephites? What happened to Samuel? It says the Nephite shot arrows at him. They're using the bow. But here, the Lamanites are casting their arrows. And this is how you use an atlatl. You literally cast just like you were fishing. You have a throwing stick. The vast majority of points are found in the North America are too big to be arrow points. They're atlatl points. People find points as big and say, look, this neat arrowhead. Well, it's really an atlatl point. Arrowheads are just but this big, little bitty things. If you had an arrowhead this big, you'd have to have a shaft so long you couldn't draw it back far enough to shoot it. The physics isn't there. But on a casting, you can. It's like a mini spear. This is the weapon of choice for the Lamanites. Yes, an atlatl point. They found a point in the Zelph body. It was an atlatl point. Alma 50 and 15, and they also began in that same year to build many cities on the north, one in a particular manner, which they called Lehi, which was in the north by the borders of the seashore. Okay, I can't tell you this is the city of Lehi, but I can tell you this is a very, very unusual city. Originally talk about being the Hebrew fort. They end up called the Milford Works. It's by Milford, Ohio. And here's the waterway. What do you see here at the top? Oil lamp, isn't it? Down here we see this huge Hebrew candelabra. And they didn't know what to think of this. This thing was treated very poorly. We know that it was raised by farmers and Corps of Engineers sometime early 1900s. Right now there are several men working to reestablish this and possibly even rebuild parts of it. That's their dream to do that. And it's a worthy project. This is a very, very unusual site. And again, it's nothing like anything else. Mosiah 2 and 7, for the multitude being so great that King Benjamin could not teach them all within the walls of the temple, therefore he caused a tower to be erected that thereby his people might hear the words which he should speak. So now we know that in Nephite country, the temples were within walls. Let's take it a Hebrew. Here's a Nephite fort. Excuse me, it's Hopewell Fort. Here are the walls. Here's the ditches. Here's the temple itself. They built a special building. There's not very many of these. They're very, very selective. They're few. But this is what they are. And then for those of you who were not here yesterday, we have found a new possible site. This is what it is. It's actually in plain sight. You can go home and Google it. Call up Nauvoo, Illinois, and when that comes up on your computer, just go straight west to hit the other side, and you'll see this. Not only have we researched this very carefully, I found this last October, but we were able to do electronic work on it just 2 weeks ago, and we now know that this is definitely a man-made feature. These are earth berms that surround it, and we also found a structure right here that's 106 by 188 rectangular form. The outside here is 130 by 230, 2-to-1 ratio, and that's the ratio that we find in Solomon's Temple. So we're very excited about this, but right now we can just say, hey, we're looking at a good Hopewell site. Governor Laconius in AD 16 gathered people, gathered Nephites and Lamanites in the center of the land. This is a major enigma to the archaeologists of the Midwest. They cannot explain this. We will prepare ourselves in the center of our lands, and we will gather all our armies together, and we will not go out against them, but we will wait until they shall come against us. Here's Illinois. This is the center for the Illinois Hopewell. Here's the center for the Ohio Hopewell. And right down here is the tip of Illinois. Now, would you not agree that's pretty close to the center of the land as the circle stands? Yes? This is a sphere of influence where we find the bulk of the Hopewell, but right down here we find something very unusual for the archaeologists. At the tip of Illinois, starting at the Ohio in the east, there's an escarpment that's been raised up like an earthquake, a break in the land, and right here we have 41 fortified forts all the way across the escarpment, all the way to the Mississippi. So you have the Ohio for an east border, you have the Ohio for a south border, and you have the Mississippi for a west border, and you knock off the north, and here's your place of security in the center of the Hopewell sphere of living. And what did Laconia say? We will gather in the center of our lands to fight off who? The Gadianton robbers. To the archaeologist, this is a major puzzle. But to the Book of Mormon, this is the answer. It has to be Laconius's place. It matches nothing else. Now, he did this in 16 AD. The carbon dating here is 50 AD. Again, nice parallel. Okay? This is what they look like. It's dry masonry rock, all taken from the broken cliff face that's been raised up, and walls are thrown up all around up on top of the forts. There's about four of these you can actually get to fairly easily to see. There's some real big ones where the wall's still standing at 12 and 13 feet. They're very difficult to get to, and you'd have to go back just with a few people and numbers to climb to get there, but they are there. Breastplates and headplates. Here's the armaments that Book of Mormon talks about. These are the scriptures. Three in Alma, a Helaman, third Nephi, and an Ether. Let's take a look at the Hopewell. We find copper headplates all over the Hopewell burials. This is the copper headplate. This is the crown of your head. This is the forehead. They had some type of leather and cloth cap that held this together. These big rabbit ear things actually come down and cover your temple and your cheekbone. Copper headplates. Here we see a Hopewell person, a male, buried, and look at his head. He's wearing his copper headplate. This was a soldier buried with his helmet, as you want to call it. And we got a copper axe head sitting down here. And this is a gal, so we're presuming they're probably husband and wife buried together. Copper breastplates, they're not like the ones we see fashioned over in the Mideast. They are pretty much straight across. They're made to lay just across your immediate vitals. Fit through this hole. As you would pull it through here, then you would cinch it. Pull it through and cinch. And that's how they held them on. And what these two holes here are for, we do not know. But these copper plates also preserved the fabric these people were wearing as they were buried. And if you go to Columbus, Ohio, they have multiple drawers, about 20. And each drawer, they have colored fabric that these people wore. They weren't wearing plain buckskin. They had woven fabric of bright colors. And you can see all that in Columbus. What size what? The Hopewell people are our size. They're just like we are. Same type of thing. We also have arm shields. This has little bitty holes all the way around. These were sewed onto some type of a shirt that was put on. This would be up on your shoulder blade, up on top. Copper points are common. You go to Milwaukee, Wisconsin, you'll find out these holes here. The pins were held on with iron rivets drilled into the wood shaft. Milwaukee is the only place I know that has the iron pins, but they are there. And these are the beautifully copper made. These here are smelted, by the way. These are not cold hammered. I own these artifacts. I've had them checked out. This is the latest find. We showed this yesterday, a 21-inch copper sword that was found just this past summer, Lake Superior, all hardened copper. The guy's walking the beach with his dog, and I don't know if it was the front or the handle, but a tipple was sticking out of the sand. He just bent over, and voila. How's that for a morning walk? And then here's the same sword right here. I'm just showing you a picture of some others, because right here, what do we call a curved sword for our big 20 objections? Scimitars. Well, I can show you three scimitars in private collections, just in Wisconsin. And I know there's some in Indiana and Michigan as well. We have scimitars, and we have swords. So that's not a problem. 1611, nevertheless, after many days, their dead bodies were heaped upon the face of the earth, and they were covered with a shallow covering. These we call battle mounds. We know that they exist because we find them, we see them, and when they are found and uncovered, this is what you see. This one here is men, women, and children. They've all been killed with a blow to the head. And these battle mounds are from Wisconsin to Tennessee and New York to Missouri. Very, very common. There's lots of them. This one comes out of New York. In New York, we don't find them in piles. We find these bones in the actual ditches where the fortifications lay. After the fort was taken, the dead were pitched into the ditches and covered over there and left to rot. And that's where these come from. Over 250 forts just in western New York. Okay? So, Joseph and Hiram. I can't say enough for what these guys, I know for a fact that Joseph knew way, way more than he ever revealed about the history of this land. He had to have. And I want to just share one little thing with you right here. And this is my new DVD coming out. Just got to give you a plug. This is only a minute. Haven't got much for sound, I see that. Pardon? To help? That's right. What that was demonstrating, Joseph Smith, this is one of the most profound things I had happen in my life. I was reading his work, leaving the Ohio here on the Zion's Camp March. He crosses all of Ohio, he crosses Indiana, he comes into Illinois, and he goes to the Zelfmon, which is right here, the Illinois River. But then when he gets to the shores of the Mississippi, he writes this great big letter to his wife. I've just pulled out the important parts. Of course, this is by Dean C. Jesse, Personal Writings of Joseph Smith. We arrived this morning on the banks of the Mississippi. We left the eastern part of the state of Ohio, wandering over the plains of the Nephites, recounting occasionally the history of the Book of Mormon, roving over the mounds of that once beloved people of the Lord, picking up their skulls and bones as proof of its divine authenticity. Signed, Joseph Smith, Jr. I got to tell you, folks, raised in Wisconsin, running through the hills of the Hopewell as I have done, when I found this many, many years ago, this really set me on fire. My first question is, why hasn't this been in the Ensign? Why hasn't Joseph why haven't we championed the things Joseph has shared us? And there's more to come. And these are questions that I can't answer. This is the sphere of influence by the archaeologists where the Hopewell is. This is where Joseph left, East Ohio, all the way across over here. This is their area, picking up their skulls and bones as proof of divine authenticity. Now, before he wrote that letter, he stopped at the Illinois River, where they crossed at Pike's Ferry, and this is what was written about that. And this was written by a scribe, but Joseph is the one doing the talking. During our travels, we visited several of the mounds which had been thrown up by the ancient inhabitants of this country, Nephites, Lamanites, etc. And this morning, I went up on a high mound near the river. On top of the mound were stones which presented the appearance of three altars, having been erected one above the other, according to the ancient order. Now here's an uneducated man who understands the ancient order of altar building. And the remains of the bones were strewn over the surface of the ground. The brethren procured a shovel and a hoe, and removing the earth to the depth of about 1 foot, discovered the skeleton of a man almost entire, and between his ribs a stone point of a Lamanitish arrow, which evidently produced his death. Elder Burr Riggs retained the arrow. That elder is in the church possession today in Salt Lake. Just so you know, it is real. The contemplation of the scenery around us produced peculiar sensations in our bosoms, and subsequently, the visions of the past being opened to my understanding by the Spirit of the Almighty. What's happening to Joseph here? Okay. I discovered that the person whose skeleton was before us was a white Lamanite, a large, thick-set man, and a man of God. His name was Zelph. He was a warrior and a chieftain under the great prophet Onondagas, who was known from the hill Cumorah, or Eastern Sea, to the Rocky Mountains. Tremendous information here. Okay, I'm not going to read this here. Let's just go back up here for a minute. Number one, when we find words that are still in use today, we should stop and pay attention. And the word I want to point out here is Onondagas. Where do we find this word today? Onondaga, New York. And how about a people? The six nations of the Iroquois. One of them is called Onondaga. Onondaga, Onondagas. I don't think there's any mistake in that. We also find in the Book of Mormon a name called Oneida. We also find one of the six nations of the Iroquois is named Oneida. Very interesting. These should be red flags for us. Also, this hill Cumorah or Eastern Sea to the Rocky Mountains. What body of water is the New York Cumorah sitting next to? Ontario. Lake Ontario. Very good. Let's go on. Now, here's the important part. History of the Church, 1948 edition, volume 2, pages 79 and 80. Through error, the part of this quotation naming the hill Cumorah and specifying that Zelph had died in the last great struggle was omitted in editions prior to 1948. It was, however, quoted correctly as written by the prophet and here given in volume 6 of the Times and Seasons of January 6, 1846. So the bottom line is, if you have a History of the Church set prior to 1948, put it on eBay, get rid of it. You're missing a lot of good information. Okay? You got a bum set. You want to get this set because this is in there. That's what's important. It's very, very key for Book of Mormon. So, it took me 4 years because I lived in Wisconsin. I decided I was going to find the Zelph Mound. It took me 4 years because in Illinois, all the mounds just have numerical names. They didn't call it the Zelph Mound, so I didn't know. I just knew I had to go to Pike County. It took me 4 years to find it. And eventually I did. And what happened was, I got to the day where I was really close, and I knew it, and I got down to this area. It's a state preserve, fish and game. People can hunt there. And I saw a house where the ranger lived, and I was very excited, and I wasn't very careful. And I ran up to the door, and I beat on this guy's door, and this guy stepped out to his front door, all dressed up, had his big badge on, his Smokey the Bear hat, you know, the whole nine yards. And I said to him, "Hi, I'm Wayne May from Wisconsin. I'm looking for the Zelph Mound." He looked at me really strange. He said, "Young man, are you a Mormon?" And I thought, oh boy, I did something now. I said, "Yes, I am." He said, "Well, you want the Mormon Mound. It's right over there." So So somebody had already been there and identified, which was okay. So I got to the Mormon Mound, or the Zelph Mound, and this was it. And it was very, very neat. Now, one thing that was really, really special, however, the state of Illinois archaeology team came here, and they cut a trench right through the middle of it. Okay? Now remember, Joseph called this a Hopewell Mound. During the last great struggle of the Nephites, a fight. They cut a trench through here. These are copper axes taken out of the mound, and they took all kinds of artifacts. But the first dates, 79 to 87, were 250 AD plus or minus 100 years. Well, if you go plus 100 years, 350 AD, that's getting really close to the time of the last great struggles. Okay, but maybe we can also go the other way, and it's pretty early. But then guess what happened? For some reason, they either did some more work on the mound or they redated some carbon material. The archaeologists at the Dixon Mound site, which is very close to Zelph, new dating on the Zelph Mound material has been adjusted to 380 AD. And what are we talking? When did it end? 385 to 387. Boy, this is really close. These are non-LDS people verifying the prophet, the founder of our church, who called this mound exactly what it is, a Hopewell burial mound and a battle mound. Many, many men are in here. At this same mound, as you go up the Illinois River, there's over 51 mounds in a half a mile distance, and they're all this size, about 150 feet long, 30 to 40 feet high. A lot of people are buried on this riverbank. One heck of a fight took place here, a big fight, all identified by Joseph. And then 4 years later, he goes on the Kirtland March. He did not write this. He did not have a scribe write this, but 3 to 4 journal entries from the men who were with him on that march. Joseph identifies Manti. The camp passed through Huntsville and Randolph County, which has been appointed as one of the stakes of Zion and is the ancient site of the city of Manti. Samuel D. Tyler writes, September 25, 1838, we passed through Huntsville County, seat of Randolph County, and this is the ancient site of the city of Manti, which is spoken of in the Book of Mormon. And you find this in your book, Teachings of the Prophet Joseph Smith. So, I got to thinking, well, what do you think? If this is correct, and we also find out what? South of Manti in the Book of Mormon, what do we find? Waters of Mormon. And what do we find in North America? If you go south of Northern Missouri for Huntsville, you drop almost to the Arkansas line, and we find the largest fountain of fresh water in North America. Isn't that amazing? 239 gallons of water blowing out of the earth every day, 7 days a week, called Big Spring, Missouri. It varies. Here's where it is. It used to blow out of this hole right here. This is all limestone. It's very soft, and it's eating its way deeper. This is about a 40 to 50 foot deep hole right here. This water is absolutely gorgeous. It's as beautiful as the ocean. You can see the people walking here. See how big this is. It's just gorgeous. And it's in the right direction according to the Book of Mormon. Well, I think we're starting to get some benchmarks. Joseph, on the other hand, living here, strung out just like everybody else, early days of the United States. In the 1800s, this was called the western part of the United States. So in the writings of Joseph, when he talks about going to the west, he's not talking about crossing the Mississippi. West is off the Appalachians into the Ohio Territory. This is the west. And you have to understand that in the writings, because if you miss that, you'll be going to the wrong place. So in that time, he wrote a letter. He says to Mr. Seaton, he was editor of the Rochester newspaper, he said, "Dear sir, I was somewhat disappointed on receiving my paper with only a part of my letter inserted in it. The letter which I wrote you for publication," that's in the Rochester newspaper, "I wrote by the commandment of God, and I am quite anxious to have it all laid before the public, for it is of importance to them." History of the Church, Volume 1, page 326. And what did they leave out? This is what they left out. The Book of Mormon is a record of the forefathers of who? Of our western tribes of Indians. I think that's pretty significant. Who is living in the Ohio Territory in 1830? The great Algonquin family. Shawnee, the Delaware, all these guys. And so what happens? Joseph Doctrine and Covenants, Section 32, and also History of the Church, Volume 1, 118 to 120. He now gets the Book of Mormon off the press. Joseph Smith sends Oliver Cowdery, Parley Pratt, Zeba Peterson, Peter Whitmer Jr. to preach the gospel to the Lamanites residing in the West, revealing to them the sacred book with the history of their forefathers. And where'd he go? New York, Iroquois, Wyandots, Ohio, Shawnee, Ohio, Delaware, Pennsylvania. These are the first people to be preached the gospel to. Over 100 years passed before we went south to the Rio Grande. These are the descendants of Lehi. This is the remnant of Jacob. This is where we're finding the DNA today that matches the Middle East, right here in North America. Another one really good. We talk about seasons. This came up yesterday. Migrations. We now know that the buffalo were, there's just as many buffalo over here in the east as they were in the west. The buffalo here was a little different, just a little bit smaller as a type of animal, but yet they were still recognizable and the same. And they migrated back and forth. And what I found out, and boy, it's so strange, because I was in fourth grade when this happened to me. I had no idea where this was going, but I live right up here. And we took a field trip over to the Mississippi River, and we were looking at some pioneer log cabins and old stuff like that, and, you know, that kind of drill, which was fun. But while we were there, I never forgot, they told me that this is where the herd of the east buffalo would cross to go into the land north in the summertime to eat the grasses there, to get away from the hot and the humidity. They would go north, and they crossed right here at Mondovi, Wisconsin, just a little south of where I live. And guess what county they named Mondovi after? It's Buffalo County. Okay? So here we have migrations. Now, what's important about this is that in Central and South America, there are no migrating beasts. But the Book of Mormon tells us of beast migrations because the Lamanites follow them for the stragglers to get food. Migrations. North America only. So, where's the neck? Where's Sidon? Where's Zarahemla-Manti? Waters of Mormon, Valley of Gideon, Narrow Strip. All right. Ether 1020, they built the great city by the narrow neck of land, the place where the sea divides the land. Now, around the Great Lakes, we got a lot of narrow necks. We got a lot of places we could pick, but my choice is right here at Niagara. Hill Cumorah is sitting right here. Here's the Niagara. And this is called the neck. And we know, because of the early Iroquois people speaking the Algonquin tongue, that the word Niagara turns out to be a pre-Book of Mormon reference which supports Joseph Smith. And Niagara, of course, simply means the neck. Joseph did not make this up. It was a very important place the Native Americans used to control. Now, in there's two things. They talk about the narrow pass. They also talk about the narrow neck. And I believe they are two separate locations. The narrow pass, I believe, runs right here through present-day Detroit into the Toronto area and in. This would go from the Northlands to the south. They talk about blocking the narrow pass. If this were the narrow pass and they did the block here, that would make no sense at all. That's why I believe there are two. Also, there's a second thing that backs this up, and it's right here. This is called the Niagara Escarpment. This also is a raised area through geologic disturbance, creating a very narrow corridor along the Erie, up right up here, just south of the Hill Cumorah. And right here on top of this escarpment, we find very roughly made hilltop forts. And they all fit the Hopewell timeline. And why are the forts there? Because they're blocking this escarpment, a way to flow up here. If that were the case, then the waters here, which we believe from our present geologists, this was much, much deeper. The lakes were bigger, much wider, and all the shoreline here can be well documented that the water was much, much higher during Book of Mormon times. I should say Hopewell times, excuse me, to flow in here. Lake Ontario, Lake Erie. Otherwise, these forts would make no sense. They had to be blocking this way, which means this way was not a way to pass. Too deep, too big, too swift, too broad. The Niagara Escarpment. And of course, that brings us to this, 125:3, let them build up a city into my name upon the land opposite the city of Nauvoo. Let the name of Zarahemla be named upon it. All of us can demonstrate in the scriptures that the Lord used certain places time and time again, over and over and over again. And so here, this is my choice for Zarahemla. And even now, probably more than ever. In the first book of the Joseph Smith Papers, you will find in there an early map from Joseph. He went and left Nauvoo over here, crossed the Mississippi. All this black area, as poor as the saints were, they were buying up this property as fast as they could to build a new city. And of course, here's the DNC 125. Here's the area that they purchased. And of course, here's the temple. The temple is right about here today. And right over here, we have something also very, very special, which is a new find. This is the potential new Hopewell Temple site. Dare I say this could possibly be the Zarahemla Temple site? We won't know until we get dating. If it fits the Hopewell timeline, then I'm going to say, yes, this is a Zarahemla Temple site. But until I get the dating, I cannot say that. But right now, it is a potential Hopewell Temple site. All the things are there, all the trappings. We have the berms. We have a building right here at 106 and 188 in shape. Foundation of the building is down 5 to 7 feet, made out of cedar posts, and we got to go after that. We are in negotiation for this property. We're looking for a lease to do the work or to purchase, and we're working on that with the landowner right now. It's been going on since October. Here's the view from the temple lot right across to Nauvoo Temple. Okay? Zarahemla 125.3. What do you think? Here's what we have for dating. We actually have dates down here as old as 600 BC, which is really great because we know that in Helaman 6, the Lord tells us that Lehi was brought into the land south, Mulek was brought into the land north. A lot of Native Americans talk about coming into the land north, into the Great Lakes. We also have them talking about coming into the Gulf. So both places are viable. But we have the oldest dates for the Hopewell coming right here out of Florida, right on the panhandle. All that can be documented. And what's really interesting about that is very similar dates are coming out of East Tennessee, of all places. We don't even know about East Tennessee hardly at all. But then we get a little better dates here around Illinois. But all the archaeologists of Ohio, they always put the starting date of Ohio at 100 BC, just when Captain Moroni began his great building program of fortifying all the cities and the states. So what's happening here, we see older dates. Lehi got here first. Zarahemla got here second. But here we find this extra date that matches because Nephi split off from Laman and Lemuel very early. And then we have a little bit to back that up. Now this is really bizarre. And this could be a real long stretch, but I'm going to give it to you anyway. This right here was a Mississippian mound site. This is in the Tennessee Valley in the 1930s when they built the dams. There were hundreds of sites up and down this river, and they let archaeologists come in for about 2 seasons to do all they could, to dig as much as they could, because all this was going to go underwater. As they dug down this Mississippian site, they found out that it was on top of a Hopewell berm. And they got down to the Hopewell berm, and they found out that in the Hopewell berm was a huge rectangular building. A huge rectangular building. Nowhere else has a rectangular building like this ever been found in a Hopewell mound. Nowhere. Now, what was really unusual about it, the archaeologists here found something that set off an alarm. And they didn't know what to do about it. But they had the courage to call Rendell Harris, who was an expert on Egyptology in England. And they brought him over. And this was what he said. The stone ruins of a large stone and wood structure uncovered beneath a Hopewell mound was made during an excavation of the site that was about to be flooded by the building of the TVA Dam project. Rendell Harris placed heavy emphasis on an Egyptian presence in East Tennessee due to the place names that were still in use by the local natives and the fact that Eastern Tennessee was rich in copper. Big, big key. Also suggesting an Atlantic crossing. Another big key. The temple was erected on the Clinch River just below an Indian burial ground, a temple in Tennessee, University of London, 1935. Did the American archaeologists champion the work of this Egyptologist? Not a chance. Under the rug. This is a problem. We've made it bigger by inviting this guy over here. Now, what's interesting, first of all, copper. What did Nephi do when he separated himself from Laman and Lemuel right away? What did he do? He built what? A temple patterned after Solomon, and he addressed it in copper. Had he traveled, assuming he still had the Liahona, had he traveled all the way to Upper Michigan to get that copper, where we know the copper is at in great quantity, he would have crossed the path of the Mulekites very, very early in the Book of Mormon. But we know that didn't happen because over 400 years passed before the Mulekites and the Nephites got together. 400 years. And the main river of the Sidon was also not mentioned until Nephi's group hooks up with the Mulekite group over 400 years later. No mention of Sidon. So Nephi had to get copper, and we now know that there is copper dug by the Hopewell people in eastern Tennessee. So the copper was there. Now, Rendell Harris mentions Egyptian presence based on place names. And I'll just tell you one. Tennessee is an Egyptian word. Did you know that? Tenna means land of. Esi means Isis. Land of Isis. Land of Isis is an Egyptian word. Okay, let's go on. So, when I first found this, it was probably about 6-8 months later, and I always tell a story, it was so funny. I was sitting in Sunday school, and all this stuff is flowing around in my brain. I'm just trying to concentrate on the class, I'm trying, but the stuff's in my head, I can't shut it out. And we're happening to be in the Book of Omni. And I'm reading down here, and they departed out of the land into the, now this is when Mosiah gets the word from the Lord, take the people of Nephi, I want you to travel to Zarahemla, wherever it is, I will lead you through the wilderness, and we're going to become one people. Okay. And they departed out of the land into the wilderness as a man would hearken unto the voice of the Lord, and they were led by many preachings and prophesying, and they were admonished continually by the word of the God, and they were led by the power of his arm through the wilderness until they came down into the land, which is called the land of Zarahemla. Now, the key here is down. They came down into the land. Because when they got down into the land, later on, a couple of groups or a group wanted to go back to the land of Nephi. And so what did they say? And now I would speak somewhat concerning a certain number who went up into the wilderness to return to the land of Nephi. And then here again in 28, wherefore they went up into the wilderness. Right then I knew that the directions in the Book of Mormon has nothing to do with the coordinates of north, south, east, and west. It's elevation. Because they live on the rivers, they understand the flow of the rivers, and they're living by elevation. Up and down is elevation. It has nothing to do with the coordinates, north, south, east, or west. Elevation right here in Tennessee, highest point, 3,000 feet to 1,800. You go all the way down to Zarahemla in Illinois, where I've picked it, 600 to 300 feet. So you leave the copper mines of eastern Tennessee, a place where we find the Hopewell at 500 BC, and you walk all the way down to Zarahemla. And you want to go back home, you walk all the way up to Tennessee. Elevation. Okay? If you got something better, let me know. All right, this is about to close here, about at the end. This was given to me by a friend who found this. Matter of fact, he's an expert on Brother Talmage. He's written two books. His name is James Harris. He lives in my daughter's ward in upstate New York of Albany. May 20th, 1917, Professor W.C. Mills, now he's the head man for Ohio, he is having conversation with James Talmage, a prophet of our church, apostle. And he lists 9 things about these people. Ohio was once inhabited by 2 distinct peoples. These 2 classes were contemporaries. These 2 peoples were generally in a state of hostility. During limited periods, there was friendly intercourse. Both cultures were very generally affected by syphilis. The lower culture was most commonly the sailing party, while the people of the higher type defended as best they could, but in general fled. Isn't that interesting? They buried their dead by the heaping of earth. The general course of migration through the area now defined as a state of Ohio, and this is so key, was inward from the west and outward toward the east. Are you envisioning that? Zarahemla Falls, where's that in relation to Ohio? It's in the west. And the Book of Mormon, they move then in an eastward direction into Ohio. Ohio Falls, and where do they go? Into Pennsylvania and into New York. Look what these guys understood in 1917 for North America. Has anybody seen this before? I know, but it's there. Okay? All right. Gentiles, and I will fortify this land against all other nations. Is this Mexico? Is this Guatemala? Is this Honduras? Is this Panama? Is this Argentina? Is this Ecuador? Does anything fit south of the Rio Grande? Tell me honestly, does it fit? I want to hear it.
No.
Awesome. Professor Nibley says, he summarizes the archaeological problem, and I'm going to be done here, one more slide. Book of Mormon archaeologists have often been disappointed in the past because they have consistently looked for the wrong things. We should not be surprised at the lack of ruins in America in general. Actually, the scarcity of identifiable remains in the Old World is even more impressive. In view of the nature of their civilization, one should not be puzzled if the Nephites had left us no ruins at all. People underestimate the capacity of things to disappear and do not realize that the ancients almost never built of stone. Professor Hugh Nibley, approached the Book of Mormon. And this one is my favorite. I got this about two Christmases ago. It comes out of the Prophetic Book of Mormon, Volume 8, Chapter 14. If you got the set, you want to write that down. What most impressed me last summer on my first and only expedition to Central America was the complete lack of information about anything. Isn't that classic Hugh? The Book of Mormon is a history of a related primitive church, and one may well ask what kind of remains the Nephites would leave us from their more virtuous days. A closer approximation to the Book of Mormon picture of Nephite culture is seen in the earth and palisade structures of the Hopewell and Adena culture areas than in the later stately piles of stone in Mesoamerica. Professor Hugh Nibley. And again, I always show this in case I got a plant out here, right? Gotta keep it straight. There's my website. Website is down right now, but it's gonna be up hopefully next week. And we're gonna have a lot of free stuff out there for you, and I'll turn the time back over to Paul.